If you can hear me, and when you want to ask a question, there's a chat feature down at the bottom of your screen. You can type in a question, or at some point, I think I'll try to get everybody's screen on my screen so I can see anybody who's waving at me or trying to raise their hand to ask a question. And we made my assistant, Ted Bergman, made up a little video that we're going to play here to start and just kind of summarize our time since September together, and features a bunch of our players and some of the initiatives that we undertook. And it's got rock and roll music, so if you don't like loud music, you might not like this. And if you, extra bonus, free Harvard t-shirt if you can name the band. And bonus, if you can name the band that did the song originally, then I'm really impressed. So Bob Glatz is nodding his head. So should I go, Bob?
Yeah, well, let me just say a quick word before we get going. Thank you, everybody, for signing on. I'm Bob Glatz. I'm the Broadbent Family Executive Director of the Varsity Club. And this is our office hours. This is our number 6 in the series. We're psyched to have Coach Byrne, who you just heard, the Frisbee family head coach of men's lacrosse. If you don't know about Coach, he is the 18th coach in the men's lacrosse program. Coming to us from Notre Dame, where he's an assistant coach for 16 seasons. In 14 of those 16 seasons, they went on to the NCAA tournament. He was quite a player himself at UMass Amherst. And rumor is he graduated cum laude, which is fabulous. So
that's Latin.
In Latin. So not only is he handsome and a great coach, but he is wicked smart. And we're really glad to have him now as the Frisbee family head coach for men's lacrosse. So Gerry, you want to roll the video?
Yeah, let's roll the video. Here we go.
All right, do it.
No matter how hard you try, you can't stop us now. No matter how hard you try, you can't stop us now.
Okay.
So sorry if that didn't come through that clear, but I wanted one of my assistants, Ted Bergman, and Will Corrigan and Neil Hutchinson, Steve Looney and Lars Kyle. I wanted, you know, get a sense of the variety of things that we've been up to since the middle of July. And I think it was a montage of things that I asked them to put together. It didn't cover everything, but I think it's indicative of the lacrosse stuff that we've done and the off the field efforts that we've taken in service and in travel, as well as our efforts to connect with not only the alums and the friends, but also the influencers that, you know, affect the current state and the future of our program, the high school coaches and the club coaches and the you know, seventh, eighth, ninth, 10th graders who are trying to affect where they aspire to play in college. So hopefully that came through. I don't know if it did, but hopefully you got a sense of what we've been up to. Welcome to everybody. How's everybody doing? Everybody's good? There's a chat feature that our friends from the Harvard Varsity Club will be monitoring, so you're free to unmute yourself and just jump in. I don't stand on parliamentary procedure, so if you have questions, just jump right in, or you can type it in the chat, and I promise we will go through every one of them. Having not done these before, but having interacted with a bunch of the alums back in at the alumni weekend and different messages I've gotten, there's usually a pretty consistent questions around how is admissions going or what does recruiting look like and how come Yale gets to have a 31-year-old on their team who's having a seventh year of lacrosse and who faces off. There's always questions about our rivals within the league, and I am open to any question, or I can just riff about, you know, some of those topics if you'd like.
Hey, Gerry.
Yes.
Thanks for doing this. I'd be interested to hear what you're doing in terms of communication with the team, through the spring, including the seniors, and then as you guys enter into June, communication with, the junior, sophomores, freshmen, and incoming freshmen.
So how we're communicating with the current members of our team, Will?
Yeah, just like keep in touch, whether it's Zoom, email, anything that you guys are doing, it'd be interesting to hear.
I think, probably a little chronology over the last 2 months would be helpful. We the president came and spoke to all the president of the university came and spoke to all the coaches, and he kind of gave a heads up, to be honest with you. I left that meeting, I think, in late February, early March, feeling like it would be, we're not going to be able to finish our season. So I think from that point, besides kind of cherishing each day that we had with our guys over those last 2 weeks, was, starting to think about how do we strategize to do a good job at this time. So when, even before they left campus, we were, my assistants, because I think technology is like the clapper, I need all those guys to help me do all the things I envision for our program. So we kind of quickly familiarized ourselves with Zoom and the different you know, all the different options, whether it was Microsoft Office or some of the other technology that we had, and how we could integrate that into a way that our guys, we could communicate with them, but also help them get better while we were apart. So, you know, they left on, you know, by the middle of March, and, you know, to their credit, and I think it was probably a function of not just their personalities, but the fact that they had gone through a disconnection the previous year when there was a changing of the coaches, that they had already organized themselves into what they call pods of five or six guys. And they did kind of a draft and had a nice mixture of guys from different parts of the country and different classes each represented. So they had those groups in place. As a staff, we got the workouts that we wanted them to do for the next 2 months. And so we got that into their hands. So they had, you know, they had to quickly leave campus, but they had a group that they could be connected with electronically. And they started the workouts and competitions within those pods really quickly. And while that was happening, we started, you know, doing, we had a group Zoom, but I was really reticent about doing that too much, because you quickly learned that they were, you know, the anxiety about leaving campus, the unsure nature, you know, of what their season was over, but there was always hope that something could happen in the future, being home again, which they didn't foresee for another couple of months. And so I didn't want to be too intrusive in that transition. So I wasn't detached, because that's not the wrong word, but I liked the way the pods were coming together. I loved the leadership that we had on our team, and they were doing their classes and back with their families all in a house. And that could be a great thing, or it could be a stressful thing. So I was really reticent in the beginning, and ultimately we've done a probably three full team Zooms since March. It's not because I don't want to see the guys, but it's more that I want to be respectful of their time. And I was also really comfortable with how everything else was going for them, that as a coach and a leader, the last thing you want to do is screw up something that's going well. And that the only way that can happen is by sticking your nose into something. I didn't want to do that. So I liked how that came together, and they were competing against each other. They were checking in to share information on books and movies. I was texting with them probably four or five times a week, giving recommendations on books and documentaries and sharing articles and book recommendations. So I wasn't hovering, I was in their midst, but I wasn't kind of glomming on their time. And I felt like I was willing to make that bet. I was willing to bet on our guys that they cared about the program and that they would do the work on their skill side and the workout side, and that if they were communicating with each other so well, I didn't really want to get in the middle of that. So a couple of texts a week, recommendations of books and movies and documentaries pretty consistently. I think we've done three full team Zooms, and I think I've done three Zooms with each pod in the last 2 months. So did I answer your question, Will?
Yeah. It's not a normal thing to happen in the spring and middle of the season, middle of the year. So I was just interested to see, you know, how you guys approach that. Yeah, Sounds like a good idea.
I don't know if I did it right or wrong. It's one of those things that from an evaluation of skill and conditioning, it's hard to hide the fact if you didn't do that. We'll find that out in August and September if we're back together again, which I hope we are. We'll find that out really quickly, because the clock doesn't lie. And the 45 pound plate and the bar doesn't lie. So if you're not doing the fundamental things of what a high end Division I athlete should be doing, we'll find that out. And, you know, if that's in September, you know, it's not going to cripple you for the rest of your career. It just means you're going to be behind. But I was willing to bet, by stepping back a little bit more and trusting the team and trusting the leadership, that that I think we can grow, because I think their independent accountability and their inter-accountability amongst each other, I want them to do it for themselves, for their teammates, for Harvard. The last thing I want them to do it is out of sort of fear or obligation to me. And so I'm willing to roll the dice. And I from what I can gather, I think that trust will be rewarded. What else? So, you know, that, if you have more questions about that, it's an interesting challenge for sure. We're about to head into a different phase. We're changing the pods. We're mixing them up because I want to try to cross-pollinate that leadership that's been developed, and I want other guys to work with each other in a different way. And we're starting a new workout. We did 2 months of one stuff, and now we're start a new phase.
Hey, Coach, Fred Kessler here. Thank you. I have a couple questions. One is about whether you've heard anything about the overall evaluation of the Department of Athletics and what effect it might have on men's lacrosse. And secondly, whether you know of any impact at this point of the new athletic director on men's lacrosse and what those impacts are.
As far as the study, just in case, you know, some people might not know, Fred, that's a really good question. The study hasn't been completed yet, as far as I'm aware. We haven't been given, you know, the final results. We were given an overview about 2 weeks ago, and but the full results haven't been divulged to us yet. You know, they involved a lot of interviews on their part, a crazy amount of data. Crazy amount of surveys for the coaches and for the student athletes. I imagine as far as what the effect may be, you know, my hope would be, I'll tell you, I told them a variety of very specific things when I had my interview, and I had only been here for a couple of months, but you know, comments around facilities and food for athletes and access to nutrition, you know, particularly if your practices are coming up against access to the different houses for meals. So I think there was a pretty consistent message coming from coaches and from the student athletes around their experience, performance-wise, facilities-wise, access to resources-wise, and then you know, the athletes, and I think probably some of the coaches talking about the relationship between the academic part of campus and athletics. So I think there was some real candid and transparent dialogue around that. And the company that they hired to coordinate that data gathering, I think is still kind of distilling that down to a way that the coaches are going to be able to read it and digest it. I would imagine, and I don't know this for sure, that the new athletic director, was probably privy to a lot of the net results of that and what maybe some of the suggestions going that will be given to the corporation or to the university. So I can't imagine she would accept the position without having clarity on that. As far as Aaron, the new AD, the head coaches, and I think some of the athletic department leadership met her on a Zoom call. And, you know, I'm a regular guy from Long Island in New York, and you know, I like to go with my gut. And my gut was that she was great. And it wasn't just that she was just great on the call. I felt like she was energetic and vivacious and, you know, clearly excited. And I also love the fact that she mentioned winning a couple of times. That doesn't seem to be always be a word that is thrown around. It always seems to have a comma after it relative to, obviously athletics is only part of Harvard. And we all know that. We don't need those commas all the time when people are making speeches. By comma, I mean, it always has some sort of clause that comes after it that obviously nothing's bigger than Harvard. And so, but she was great. And the fact that she talked about winning and a championship experience and a championship culture and the fact that her resume from University of Chicago mentioned, you know, different championships that the teams have won at her previous job. I thought those were all good signs. I'm looking for good signs. And so I really liked her energy. I don't know her personally, but, you know, she's went to school about 2 miles from where I grew up. She went to Hofstra and then worked at Princeton with a bunch of people that I know through lacrosse. And so the feedback that I've gotten from people that know her through the lacrosse world has been really positive. So what it means for lacrosse, I think any athletic director has to always have the appearance of objectivity relative to all sports. I think that's part of the job description. But I definitely got a sense that her being an athlete herself, that, you know, we're all athletes on this, on some level in this, on this screen. And, you know, I never want to stop thinking about winning and losing. It's what keeps me going. And so I love the fact that she was a, you know, Division I basketball player, and she obviously understands what it means to be a student athlete and those pressures. And then having been at, you know, Columbia and Princeton and Chicago, you know, places that you have to find a way to balance those things. I'm really hopeful. So hopefully I answered your question.
Hey, you Coach. Did. Thank you, Coach.
You're welcome. Coach,
Michael Coach, Fodd, LA, can you hear me?
Go ahead, Michael.
Hey, you know, I'm just wondering how many of this group is away from the East Coast, and I'm on the West Coast, obviously, and I'm curious about those of us on the West Coast. There's a lot of talent up here or over here, and I'm wondering what we can do to help on the recruiting front.
You know, that's a tricky question, you know, because there are responsibilities as you know, you always remain what is called a representative of athletic interests. So, you know, you could be 101 and, you know, you're still, you know, a representative of the athletic interests at Harvard. And so, I think obviously keeping your eyes open and, you know, if you stay connected to the game, and I know you have, Michael, is if you stay connected to the game, you're going to hear and see things and become aware of people. Feel free to drop us an email. We're, you know, we are bird dogging. We're in the bushes, and we are, you know, my assistants who are all on this call, and I'll shout them out, Will Corrigan, Steve Looney, Neil Hutchinson, Ted Bergman, and Lars Kyle. You know, we're out there. I told our guys, we respond to every email. We watch every highlight video, every recommendation that comes our way. And if they were able, you know, if they were going to talk here, they'd know I'm pretty militant about following up and the service element of when you get recommendations, whether it comes from an alum or whether it comes from, you know, a coach that or program that you may never hear of. You have to have that fear that that's going to be the guy that's going to help your program. So I continue to be, you know, wear your colors and your Harvard gear with pride. If you're involved in the game, you know, stay involved. And, you know, if you get to the point where there's an intersection between someone who you know and someone that we're recruiting, my advice is, and I've given this advice to a couple of our young alums who are living in those geographies where there's a lot of kids. Like, we have a bunch of kids from the Northern California and Southern California. When I was at Notre Dame, I recruited that area really aggressively. I'm a big fan of the athletes from out there, but, you know, we got guys in Long Island and Baltimore and upstate New York and the more traditional areas, as well as the Midwest, is that if you come across a guy that you know and that we like, we can have that conversation. My advice for you would be is less is more. Like, if you're too aggressive, if you're too over the top, it can turn kids off and parents off. You know, be a resource. Answer their questions, be honest. You know, you don't have to sell. Most of the kids are pretty, you know, smart. They know when someone's trying to hit them over the head too much with the Harvard stick. And so there's a delicate approach to that. But please send us any names or people you hear of, for sure.
Great, we'll do. And also, likewise, keep us informed about who you might be talking to that we can help with.
We'll do. We're my assistants, you know, we ARMS is the database software that we use. And again, in my previous life, I had to think about kind of data mining and marketing messages and things like that before I got back into coaching. So my assistants who are nodding off screen somewhere know that when we get information, it goes into their file, because we want to know, like, we have a bunch of questions that ask about their connection to Harvard and alum, you know, family members who went to Harvard, you know, neighbors and things like that. So we're always looking for that intersection where we can pile on the Harvard story with the potential for Harvard lacrosse with, you know, I refer to it as putting the tanks surrounding the prospect, and the tanks are the different people and messages that we can bring to bear to convince someone to come to Harvard.
Coach, Mark Leschly here from West Coast. How you doing? As, I have a son coming in as a freshman. I see some good familiar faces on here like Kristen and Jennifer and others. I guess I have a broader question about, I haven't spent any time digging into what the current positioning or options are, or timetable for when you're going to be communicating various things. We're obviously all anxious about coming back to school, online, hybrid, not. Access to facilities, not access, you know, seasons shifting, you know, the NCAAs have come up with stuff around football and basketball. Is there anything at this point that's publicly being communicated around timetables? I appreciate that no decisions and this isn't the forum for it, but, you know, we're ultimately trying to give guidance and purpose to these kids. And, you know, it's a rough going here. I'm trying to think about how to plan.
The, you know, Harvard is going to make an announcement, I think, in early July. I think, you know, and I don't know this for sure, but I think just making sense that, you know, the state starting opening up the first phase and going through these phases, I think their approach is if they see what the governor is doing, that sometime in the middle of June or the end of June, there's either the cases haven't, you know, bloomed or come back, or there has been a second wave, or, you know, it hasn't. And I think if those number of cases stay low, then I think Harvard will probably move to some, you know, hybrid, you know, combination of whether it's waves of people coming in for different parts of the fall and hybrid, partly remote, partly live on campus, where they can thin campus and not have all the undergraduates back. I don't have any proof of that. What I do know is Harvard's going to make a decision in early July about what the fall is going to be. And I think the reasoning for that is they want to have what the end of May and all of June looks like as far as what the impact of opening, not just in Massachusetts, but in a lot of states where people are coming from, and what does that look like. So I don't have an answer relative to that, but that's the timing that Harvard has been telling us. As far as the facilities and things like that, I think that'll go hand in hand with what, you know, how these phases, you know, the effect on cases that these, the phased rollout in Massachusetts creates.
Hey, Gerry.
Yes.
Kevin.
Hey, Kevin, my old landlord.
So pre-COVID, What's been the biggest adjustment for you?
As far since I got to Harvard?
Yeah.
You know, I think probably the biggest adjustment has been the, you know, the Ivy League rules and the, you know, and the amount of time that you're allowed to have with your guys, which is very different than, you know, coming from an ACC school. So I knew it intellectually, because I can look at a piece of paper and you can plot out your week and know where you can have practice and when you can't have practice and things like that, the amount of film you can do. Everything is countable. Like every little thing that you do, that you interact with your guys, you have to report, and it goes into a report that counts up the total number of hours that you're with your players. So kind of looking at a rule on a piece of paper is one thing, living it is another. But I think that it also, much like now and learning how to teach and coach remotely, learning, going through that, what it does, or what it forces you to do, is obviously be creative with your time. It forces you to figure out how do you use technology that guys can teach themselves when they're not around you. And it puts even additional pressure on a coach and a coaching staff to create an environment where this is the best part of their day. Like, I feel like that responsibility is really important. Now, I coach hard, and I'm wound pretty tight, and I'm unbelievably competitive, but I tried not to lose the sight of that whether we were doing a drill or teaching a concept, I had to keep on reminding myself, all right, how much time have we been together so far? How many practices have we done? You know, what's been the total amount of time that we've been on the field? We're teaching them a new way to play and a completely new way of playing defense, completely new way of playing offense, and new terminology. So I constantly had to remind myself of that, But that adjustment, I think, also forced a lot of creativity. And I got to credit my assistants because they're young and technologically capable. You know, I was constantly pushing, like, how do we have to save 5 minutes. So they need to stretch before we go out on the field because I want that 9 minutes. We want to put a new drill in. So let's shoot the video of the drill, show them some clips of it being done, and then share it electronically. So when we introduce the new drill, we can save 3 minutes of talking about it. Like, we can just go and do it. So we were constantly trying to find ways to steal a minute here, 5 minutes there, so that we could get more reps and spend more time with them that was more valuable. And so that adjustment was difficult, but it also, you know, forced some creativity. And then what it also did was, and I'm proud of this, and I'm, you know, I gotta give credit to our assistants as well, is that, you know, we created an environment where they wanted to be together all the time. So they would be out there on days where we had nothing scheduled. That, you know, over and above the captain stuff that they were doing, they loved being together, and they were excited about the potential and the hope for the future. And that, probably of all the sad things, obviously not being able to play the remaining of your games, not able to find out where we're going to continue on the trajectory that we thought we were on, that's really sad. And, you know, how good of leaders we had in the senior class, you know, because they managed the team from early May to the middle of July, and they did a really good job. So then when we started in August and September with the new technology and the new rules, I felt like we already had momentum. So hope, did I answer your question?
Hey, Coach, it's Ian.
Hey,
Ian. How are you? Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit about the summer recruiting plans and how you think that'll all go with tournaments and sense? Any perspective yet on how that'll all go?
You know, I think, you know, there's a lot of stressed out club directors and tournament directors right now. You know, historically they're not well renowned for their service mentality. So yeah. I think they're learning the importance of customer service right now. I can tell you that much. you know, I think they're all scrambling. They're, you know, there's nothing locked in stone, you know, because like a state that might say, hey, we can do these events, like Florida, for example, it doesn't mean your customers are going to come, you know, just because you can do something. So I don't, you know, like the dead period keeps on getting pushed back. So there's a dead period that goes to the end of June that we can't go and have people on campus or go to watch people off campus. So that's been extended several times. So the dead period right now ends at the end of June. And I think, you know, I think for a lot of states and opening and a lot of the same things that Massachusetts will go through, trying to determine what's going to happen with phased opening. Are you going to see a ballooning of cases? So, you know, I think, you know, by middle of June, I think that for a lot of parts of the country, there'll be a sense of, you know, whether events can take place or not. But you still won't know what your customer's risk aversion or risk acceptance is going to be at that point. So, you know, for us and our staff, you know, we're working on some contingency plans to do events in and around Harvard, at some schools that are near Harvard where we can do events that are proximal to campus, but still give us the ability to do evaluation. So we're strategically working with, you know, schools and places that could host events so we could attract people who are interested in Harvard. And so what we're doing right now is a crazy amount of data collection relative to the 2022 class, which is sophomores for everybody. So the 2022 class, the current sophomores in high school, we're not allowed to communicate with them until next September 1st. We can communicate with them about camps and things, and we are kind of broadly giving them some messages around that. So I think we're well positioned for an outbound message to get our top players near Harvard campus, assuming they are risk, you know, they're willing to accept that risk at that point in their lives. So I feel like we're actually meeting again tomorrow as a staff to talk about how to execute our plan. at a place like Buckingham Brown and Nichols, which is right next to Harvard. So we have a plan in place that we're ready to execute with graphics and text messages and emails. So we're like a push button state with that. And then what we're also doing with the 2022 class is my assistants and myself, we're kind of organizing our note of what we do know, because if you're not going to see people play this summer, you got to go on recommendations and what you have seen on video and what you have seen with your own eyes. So we're kind of whittling down a group of about 400 players down to about 40 or 50 right now. And those will be the guys that we'll contact when we run that event at BBN.
That's great. Thank you.
I feel really good about where we are kind of tactically and strategically and from a messaging standpoint.
Yeah, even if you could do groups of 25 kids or whatever, I don't know whatever the total limit comes to, but that would be super, it could be super impactful. Absolutely.
And not being able to do it at Harvard, but to do it at a place where you could get out, you know, leave the field and walk to Harvard Square or walk around the yard, it's kind of the best of both worlds.
Yeah. It's great.
What else? So we talked about kind of recruiting and I'm always willing to answer questions about recruiting. I love the whole process and I like talking about it. So don't we have a good group coming in the 20 class. We have 8 people in the 2021 class, which is the current juniors, and so we're in a really good spot as far as what the future looks like, as well as the interest and engagement. So any questions about recruiting or any things about, ask away.
Gerry, you got a number of kids to switch their commitments last year when you first got there. Have the transfers out of the Ivy League or like, you know, a lot of these ACC schools or Big Ten schools now have players that'll all have an extra year of eligibility. So a lot of rosters might be outside the Ivy League, you know, stacked up for a longer period of time. Like, have you seen any recruits trying to switch into the Ivy League for that reason? Maybe more playing opportunity at a younger age?
You know, that's a really good question. And, you know, we feel like, you know, I'm always trying to find silver lining. So, you know, I could cry in my pillow about the fact that it's really hard to transfer to Harvard, or you can't do your fifth year and all of those things, or you can look at this as an opportunity. And I do. I think really the smart parents and smart kids are, you know, if you're a top player and we're only going after top players. If you're a top player, you know, if you're going to a program of any level, you know, within, you know, the top 30 in Division I, you're going to have to compete to get on the field. So you know that inherently. And no coach, I think, is ever talking about, oh, you're going to start or you're going to be this starter, because I like to assume the intelligence of the people I'm talking to, that they don't buy lines of BS like that. So, but kids know that they're going to have to come in and compete. And so but if you start adding in transfers, now it's like, oh, I got to compete against this guy for 2 years now. And then you have returnees who are going to stay at the school that they got an extra year at. You have that. Now it starts becoming, what am I signing up for? I think there's definitely, I know for sure, because we've been in conversations with some of these guys, there is definitely some buyer's remorse at some of the five or six, you know, kind of dream programs that are not in the Ivy League. And I think they're looking around and saying, you know, should I hedge my bet? Do I want to go to a place where they told me I was, you know, had a great chance to be the starting faceoff guy or the starting goalie, particularly at positions like that, where you might only have one of those every other year. If they see a logjam of talent, there's definitely some reticence. There's definitely that feeling out there, Will, for sure. There's a buyer's remorse. There's a reticence. There's a feeling that maybe we can flip some of these guys. And we're in the process. We have a list of, I had my assistants create a list of about 75 players, and probably about 60 of them are juniors, and the other 15 are juniors too, but about 60 of them are committed to other schools. And we email them consistently with Harvard messages. And so I'm trying to kind of chip away at the bricks of their conviction to a place and see, and we have a way through the different software we have to check on the engagement with emails and how many times a mom or dad are opening an email and things like that. So we have within that group of 75, there's 15 to 20 guys that are really high priority targets for us. So yeah, I like the poach game. I'm a big fan.
Great.
What else?
Coach Fred Kessler again. A question I've had, because when Bob Scalise was the athletic director, he talked about the objective for Ivy sports, Harvard sports, was to compete for an Ivy League championship, not necessarily a national championship. Sometimes it's the same thing, but many times it is not. Do you think you have the tools, given Harvard's reputation and resources and facilities and your coaching excellence and the number of slots you get, to compete for a national championship, not just an Ivy championship?
I think it's important. You got to get to the first before you can get to the second. You know, like the league is so strong now. So if you're competing in an Ivy League championship game, you're one of the 10 to 12 best teams in the country. So, and, you know, 20 years ago, if you were the 12th best team in the country, there was no way you were going to win a national championship. Now, as has been proven over the last 10 years, if you're in the top 10 or 15, you're just as good as that number one team. And so I think you have to do the first before you can get to the second. So I understand the point that you're making. You know, I think part of that is that line or that mentality from Bob was his respect to what, you know, how Harvard looks as its role in the Ivy League. You know, Bob is an unbelievably competitive guy. He's from the next town over from me, from where I grew up. And so I know he was a wicked competitor as an athlete himself. I think that was his acknowledgement of the kind of company line, so to speak. You know, for me, you know, my whole mentality is I want to win everything that I'm ever involved in. I don't care if it's me playing squash with my staff or playing pickleball with Coach Corrigan, or, you know, I don't care what it is. There's a scoreboard, it's being kept. And so I want to win every game that we have. And if we do that, then I know we're one of the best teams in the country and we'll be competing for the Ivy League championship. If you're the fourth best team in the Ivy League, does that give you a chance to win a national championship? Yes, I think it does, because it means you're going to be in the tournament and you got to win six games. You got to win the two in your tournament. You got to win four in the NCAA tournament. As far as, you know, how we're positioned or, you know, organized as a team right now, you know, listen, we need some more depth. There's no doubt about that. Our team knows that. You know, we had to deal with a lot of injuries and there were times where we didn't have enough people to practice the way that I wanted to practice. So, you know, I've made that clear to admissions. I've made that clear to Bob. It was part of my conversation during my recruitment here. It doesn't mean it stops being a battle, because it's a consistent battle and a consistent argument around kind of what you need as far as support from admissions and the number of people that you would like to have on your team. I don't think that's ever one conversation. And I also have a good memory to know what the messages were before I got here. So you can tell, you can know with 100% certainty that I'm fighting that fight as a daily thing. I'll communicate it logically, not irrationally or probably emotionally, because I am kind of emotional, but I'll present it logically and rationally about, if you've seen this sport and you watch how it's played and you watch how we practice, that you need X number of people on your team and you need X amount of depth to do it. And so it's a safety thing as well. So, and as far as like facilities, you know, yeah, there are things that we need. There are things that I've had conversations with the women's soccer staff, which we're kind of connected with through the different fields, is, you know, that's a high priority. It should be a high priority for Erin when she comes in, that if you want to have a championship experience, you have to have championship level facilities. You have to have a championship level weight room and training services and things like that. So, you know, that those conversations never stop. You have to find the right time where you get the advocacy from the corporation and the university, the support from the athletic department, and, you know, support from you all to make it all a reality. So those conversations are always being had, Fred. So I think I answered your question, and I'm breaking a sweat thinking I wish I'd be back on the field coaching right now. So
you definitely answered the question. Thank you.
Yeah. You're welcome. What else? What else, Bob? What are some questions that, you know, maybe some other coaches were asked? Any consistent things? You're muted.
No, but we can call on people, Gerry. If you want to call on some alums out there and ask them for some feedback and comments, we can do that.
I'm surprised no one's brought up the face-off guy from Yale yet. You know, I mean, so I, you know, my reaction and my assistants can attest to it is you're still only allowed 10 guys on the field, and he's very good. We're just going to have to get better. There's nothing that we can do about the fact that he transferred to Yale from Albany, and because they allow transfers to have an extra semester to finish their time at Yale. So that's why he won't be there next fall, and he'll be there next spring. It, you know, what can you do? I'm not going to cry on my pillow. I'm just going to have to coach better. That's the
Gerry. Hey, it's Char, and Morgan's here as well. Curious as to we have other people who are doing something similar, don't we, in the league? As I gather, there might be some people from Brown who have the ninth season. There might be some people from Cornell. What else do you know about who else is soaking up an extra season?
Yeah, I think Cornell's probably a real likely candidate. You know, what you don't know is the families are going to have to pay for this in a really tough financial market, you know. So I don't know, but I could definitely Cornell for sure. I haven't heard anything about Brown, but I heard maybe second or third hand about that. And, you know, my mentality is I can't change, you know, I'm rational enough to know that Harvard's not going to change its mentality and policy for me. And so, I accept it, and I think about how to recruit better and how to coach our team better and, you know, use it as a motivation. And I also try to rationalize it in my own mind that be careful what you wish for. Like having people come back, they might be bad actors. They might be, you know, not great teammates. These schools that are getting transfers and things like that, you better be careful what you wish for, because that's a really delicate. If you're trying to build a great culture in your locker room, that bringing outsiders in, even if they are talented, it's a delicate thing to do. So that allows me to sleep at night that maybe it won't work out for them, and that it'll create some drama that'll affect their culture and the quality of their play. So I could be deluding myself, but that's what I hope for.
Coach, Jamie Wiley here. Wondering what kind of style of play are you looking for and are you recruiting for? Is there any particular game that you want to craft with these teams that, you know, it's going to be successful?
I just want killers. I want this super competitive, driven, refuse to lose mentality, just killers. Because you can't coach that. It's not like a movie where the coach comes in the locker room and they cue the music and all of a sudden there's an epiphany and the guy's glowing and he's some other person. That's not how it happens. You have to recruit that mentality. And I was having this conversation with a coach from San Diego yesterday, and he knows me well enough that he's like, this guy's a killer. You know, this is the guy that you can build a foundation on. And so, because when you have that, and you have the love of competition and wanting to be part of a team, and, you know, for us, a lot of our message is around, you know, recruiting against Notre Dame, Duke, and Yale consistently is the choice is, do I go to something that's fully formed already, and that's a big part of your ego that you get to say that you're going to a top five program, or do you want to come and be a part of something that we're creating? And so we're trying, that's the other part, trying to find this adventurous spirit, this wanting to be part of something that's going to be great. And that's a unique mentality. So we have a question on our questionnaire that kind of, that we send out to our prospects, and we don't send questionnaires out to everybody. We sent out about 320 as of right now. And there's a question on there that gets to that essence of that. It's a, there's questions that provoke their competitiveness, and there's questions that provoke kind of why their interest in Harvard, and the care that someone takes to answer that question in that data mining mentality that I have, that's really insightful. So as far as what we look for, I don't get caught up in size as much, because, you know, I've coached, you know, 6'5" guys who are soft as pillows and 5'9" guys who are savages. So I don't, you know, I'm looking for compete level, IQ, selflessness, team mentality, and a real hunger to be great, and a real willingness that I don't care what my job is. I just care about the result. I care about how our team does. And so, you know, so that's the kind of the ethos and the mentality we're looking for. And when you watch a lot of film and you watch a lot of events and sitting on sidelines, it's hard to hide some of that. And then, so when you feel it, when you feel it internally, and then you start talking to their lacrosse coach and their position coach and their football coach and their basketball coach, and it starts this drumbeat of, this is who that guy is, and you like the way that they play, and you like their grades, and you like their connection and interaction with you personally, and the information they give you on their questionnaires and things like that. That all gets kind of pushed together into a stew of how you decide on people. But those are the attributes I'm looking for, and you got to recruit that. You know, our job is to further develop it, but you got to recruit it.
Coach, did you guys elect captains yet? And do you see that as a nice opportunity maybe to them take on a completely different role and a more active role with the team this summer? It just seems with all the distance and everything. Thoughts on that?
So the question was about captains. And, you know, I have a different approach to that. The team that I inherited, that we inherited in July, you know, had to manage themselves for 2 months. And the seniors that we had last year, the seniors that are still seniors because they haven't graduated yet, so I'll still call them seniors, is they did an unbelievable job. I mean, they were the caretakers of the program for 2 months. And you know, I talked to each of them probably in the first 2 weeks that I was in my position. You know, I was on the road recruiting. I wasn't even in Cambridge yet. And, you know, I was so impressed by their leadership. And then we had a captain who was coming back, Kyle Anderson, but Kyle was such an inclusive leader. He knew he couldn't do all the things that needed to be done himself. And so they created the pods that we have in place now. They did that last May, and then they did all the work in the summer, and then they organized the captain stuff in the fall. And so, you know, one of the things that I realized over time is, you don't necessarily need a title to be a leader. And just like Kyle Anderson was open to the fact that he had 12 other guys who could help him, I felt like I had 13 captains last year. And a lot of our seniors whose season was cut short, you know, all of them played. And so, you know, so they played a great role. And so I think the lesson for me, Mark, is that, you know, if you have things are going well and you have this kind of collective leadership affecting your team in a really positive way, I've learned long ago, don't screw that up. And so, you know, will we have more than one captain? You know, maybe. I know Harvard has some different rules, and I keep on getting messages from Dwayne, as our sport administrator, that I can wait to the fall. And I could wait to the fall because I think things are going well. So if they're going well, I don't know why I would want to screw them up.
Hear, hear.
Hey, Coach, it's Ian again. Do you think there'll be any rule changes over the summer that will affect the game next year? Face off, you know, shot clock, et cetera.
I wouldn't be, you know, it's funny that, the shot clock was basically voted in 2010, my former life. We played in what some people thought was one of the worst championship games of all time, 6-5 overtime. And people were like lighting their TVs on fire because there was not enough scoring. And so we all kind of voted, like 80% of the lacrosse coaches voted for a shot clock. But as we all know, it's not who votes, it's who counts the votes. And so the head of the rules committee at that time didn't want the shot clock. And so it didn't happen until till a couple of years ago. So do I think that's going to be changed a little bit? Yeah, I think I voted for that the restart shouldn't be 80 seconds again. So I wouldn't be surprised if that ended up being 40 or somewhere between 40 and 60, the restart, instead of being a full 80. I think, there's a lot of debate around the face-off. Part of it is it probably adds the face-off in a 20-goal game, probably adds, 45 minutes onto the playing time. And so there's a speed of play part of that. There's a part of it that the refs can't adjudicate it well, and that there's still a lot of cheating and the human error part of that, and the fact that it can really skew possession, that one player who's only doing this. So I don't know, but I think there's a lot of feeling around it. The third part, the dive's been a nightmare. Again, another thing that people can't judge. There's just too much going on. Where was the contact? Where did he step? Who got shoved? Where's the ball? When did he run into the goalie? Where did he land? And you have a bunch of referees that, let's be honest, they're not always in great position. And so I think those three things are probably pretty good chance of something happening, Ian. I don't know if it will, but I voted for, basically like a stand-up face-off and bringing the wings in closer so it's more of a 3-on-3. I voted to get rid of the dive because as a defensive coach, I just think they can't call it. They can't call it well, and they can't call it right consistently. In my last game that I coached at Notre Dame, we were winning with like a minute left, and a kid dove from below GLE with 1 second left in the shot clock, and the defenseman from Notre Dame hit him with a V hold perfectly, and they got a penalty, saved the shot clock, scored, and won in overtime. So I'm obviously not a fan of the dive. Never was, never will be. So what else? What else? I wrote some notes to myself. We have teams in the Lake Placid tournament. So if you want to play, make sure you communicate. I think Reed Hubbard and JJ Nollett are the point guys on that. Last year I walked over to say hello, and next thing you know, I'm on man up. Now I'm a defenseman. A defenseman shouldn't be on man up, fellas. So I was just coming over to say hello. Next thing you know, I had a jersey. So make sure if you want to play to let me know. I'll get you connected with the right guys. I think we have two teams registered for Lake Placid, and it's a great way to reconnect with your buddies and tell the old stories. And Lake Placid is, hopefully it happens. I've been there every year but three in the history of the tournament. So I'm a big fan of being up there, and so it's a great way to be connected.
They just pushed the dates back on that.
Oh, did they?
Yeah. So Coach Mike Murphy here, how you doing? Great to see everybody. Obviously a big fan of Harvard lacrosse, but also a big fan of the sport of lacrosse in general. And I was very concerned when I saw Furman make it wasn't even just lacrosse, it was multiple sports got cut. And do you see that impact is going to happen? I mean, schools are financially challenged right now. There's an evolution of what's going to happen in the fall with academics, whether they're on campus or not. It could change the financial well-being of universities. Do you see that expanding, or is that more of an isolated instance? And how are the ripple effects going to happen as schools close programs, if they might?
Yeah, I think that's probably the first of many. You know, I think that the way the Ivy League athletics are organized is, you know, puts us, I think, in a really good place because it's a mixture of support from, you know, a lot of people who are on this Zoom call, the friends and alums, and support from the athletic department. So it really ingrains the alums and the supporters into the infrastructure of the program in a really good way. And that's not true at other places, but, you know, most other places are, you know, almost exclusively fueled and funded by, you know, tuition revenue. And so if tuition revenue is in jeopardy and endowments are in jeopardy, that's, you know, it's a pretty scary situation. And then you look at the amount of travel and, you know, some of the teams that are geographically more remote than a lot of the bus rides that we take. Yeah, that's going to be a hard thing. I mean, you know, listen, Denver for years was, you know, paying teams to go out there and play because it's hard to fly, you know, if you're paying $50,000 for a trip with hotel and food and things like that. So they've been funding a lot of their home games through by doing that. And that, you know, that's going to become harder and harder to do when you're under scrutiny from the finance people. So I don't think this is going to be an isolated thing. I think the teams that aren't in leagues, there's four or five teams in Division I lacrosse that aren't in leagues right now. They're, you know, that's a troubling situation to be in, you know, for sure. The, you know, I think at the Division III level, you know, what was interesting about Furman and the other sport, baseball, that got dropped was bringing a lot of full pay students to campus. And the fact that they're letting go of that, it was kind of interesting because that, you know, for a lot of the new teams that have been added, the, you know, that's a big attractive thing that you might add 30 to 40 full pay males onto your campus. And so it's interesting that Furman is walking away from that. So, you know, listen, I don't think this is going to be the end of it by any stretch, Michael. It's kind of why events like this are really important, is the engagement with your supporters is so critical, because you need to be able to advocate the educational component, the engagement component, the, you know, the fact that athletes are more engaged, more supportive, on campus more, give more, buy more swag at the bookstore. All of these things that are happening are irrefutable. And I think this is a great time for not just Harvard lacrosse, but Harvard athletics to communicate that message, because in light of all the things that are going on and the war on a spending freeze and all the things that are going on across campuses, for you to be able to say that you have, you know, great support from your alumni and your friends program, not just financially, but just from an advocacy standpoint, is cool. So the new athletic director is coming in, and that's why I talked to our soccer staffs, because I think this is a, you know, might not seem like a great time, but this is a great time for us to talk about these are the things that we need to be that championship program that one of the other gentlemen was asking about. I don't think this is a bad time. I think it's a great time. And if she wants to come in and make a stamp, that she'll support these programs that want to play at the highest level. But that's a great question.
Coach, I'm sorry. Go ahead. I'll go next.
Mickey.
Coach Mickey Cavoti here. Thanks for having us. And Bob, Professor Glatz, thanks for everything you do and putting all this stuff together. You guys are doing great work. So really, really appreciate it. Great to see everyone. So I don't know if this question were asked before. I had to jump off for a couple minutes earlier in the call. But I've heard from some other folks in other sports that there was an overall sort of de-emphasis in the importance of athletics at the school. And I was wondering, just based on what you knew going in, what you've experienced since you've been there, have you sort of, you know, noticed that? And to what extent is that disproportionate to other Ivy League schools? If so, and how do you even address it? Even if you have the most supportive athletic director, if admissions isn't on board, you know, where does that put you?
Right. You know, I think, first of all, did you whittle that sailboat behind you? I can't tell.
Absolutely, it's amazing what a 7-year-old can do. It's impressive.
These guys from Garden City, man. You know, like if I was back in my house in Levittown, that would have been a sledgehammer in the back picture. that's a good question. I only have the 8 months that I've been there. I don't have a sense of whether I kind of walked into a situation that was worse or better. I feel like I've gotten the support I've needed from an admission standpoint, from a volume and from a support. It doesn't mean there's not drama and there's kind of actually ongoing drama within that, but I feel like my position has been supported. And what I thought it was going to be before I came and what it's turned out to be. It doesn't mean that's, you know, play tennis a little bit with some of these arguments and you're like, hey, remember when we had that conversation? Oh yeah, that's right. So I gotta be on my toes because I think there's a constant battle between admissions and athletics. But I've been supported the way I was supposed to be supported since I've been here. So as far as the de-emphasis of athletics, I don't have a sense of that. I feel like there's a undercurrent of, and I don't have any experience of it personally, but an undercurrent around maybe the way the academic world looks at athletics, you know, and conversely athletics maybe not engaging as much with the academic side of campus, whether it's coaches and professors or players and professors or student athletes within a house experience and things like that. I don't, you know, I'm always advocating with my guys that that they should be kind of worldly relative to Harvard, to take the classes that they want, to represent us, wear their gear. I told them to wear 2 pieces of Harvard lacrosse stuff in class, not none, that they should be proud of representing our program. And if you're not proud, then I need to know about that, or you're sensitive about it means maybe you're not doing what you're supposed to be doing and you're getting grouped in unfairly. So as far as like a de-emphasis strategically, I don't get that sense. I felt like the study that happened, that's still kind of just about to wrap up. Mickey, you're aware that was happening, that the study on athletics by FAS was taking place over the last 6 or 7 months. Were you aware of that?
No, I wasn't.
So they hired a consulting firm to do an assessment of athletics, the FAS, the dean did it, and along with Bob, and you know, to find out, you know, they probably heard some things about the relationship between academics and athletics, and what's the student athlete experience like? What are their struggles and frustrations? What's the frustrations from the other side of campus? And that there'll be some learning and hopefully some actions that come out of that. I don't think part of it was to come out of it and say, you know, whether it was less sports or giving less admissions spots to athletics. I don't think that was it, but I think that is always a battle. I think they're, you know, admissions is always trying to get more spots back from athletics. I think that might be just an inherent and endemic thing. But I think this study could maybe help formalize it. There's a lot of conversations around, you know, projecting what they call targets or slots into the future, so you could manage that instead of each year being like, man, I hope I get another guy, that they give you some view into the future. So I think that was a good sign. It doesn't mean you get everything that you want, but I think it was a good sign.
That's encouraging. Yeah.
Gerry, let me jump in. Bob Sherlock, Holy Family High School class of 1980.
Holy Family, let's go. We played against each other, I think.
Yes, we did. And Harvard 84. One of my neighbor's son was one of the commits from BU, Andrew DeGennaro, who's coming to Harvard in the fall.
No longer committed to BU, committed to Harvard.
interested to hear your comments about the incoming class. Where are we going in the future years?
No, I think when we started, you know, like, you know, we got going pretty good. Like I got a golf shirt overnighted to me and I left. And so I left South Bend in like the middle of July. And I think I came back in October. So we made really good progress. You know, I think there was a lot of excitement. There's a lot of pent up hope for the program. So that was a great situation for us to come into. I love recruiting. I love being on the road. I love talking to high school and club coaches and prospects. And a lot of the guys that were my targets when I was at Notre Dame, it was a pretty easy flip. So that database of guys was pretty easy to recreate. So we got right into it. And Neil Hutchinson, who supported me at Notre Dame, got on our staff really quickly. So he and I were out and about pretty quickly. And I feel like we got a top five class. You know, by the end of August, we had that class done. And it was, you know, we got guys from, you know, really good programs. We got some late bloomers. I think we flipped five guys from other schools. And so it's a nice combination of late bloomers and guys who I already knew were good from my previous position. And they were looking to upgrade, and they believed in, you know, where Harvard could go, even though we hadn't really articulated where we were going to be going yet. They had an idea to be at a great place. And so combining the, you know, the uniqueness and the special nature of Harvard and our culture, combined with, you know, our staff getting out and about, like we were on the road for weeks doing home visits and phone calls and Skype calls and doing all that. So I feel great. We have, you know, I think we have the best goalie in the class. He was committed to Navy and flipped to us. We have one of the probably two, we have a bunch of very good goalies, a bunch of very good midfielders. We have not only DeGennaro who faces off, but we have another guy who's a kind of a two-way middie who also faces off. He's not like a true face-off guy, but it's nice to have another option there. And, you know, I think it's got great potential, but my whole mentality about recruiting classes is you rank them when they graduate. I just think, you know, everybody looks good. And, you know, this generation, everybody's all something. When you were playing in all league or you're, you know, honorable mention. So I think that, you know, this is a pretty decorated class. I think every one of them, was either a high school All-American or an Under Armour All-American. Is that good, Bob?
Yeah, that's hey, great. Thank you.
So that's that was really awesome, Gerry. I want everybody to just give him a little round of applause for what he did. And I want to thank you for coming to the Varsity Club office hours. And I also want to make a plug because the tradition on campus the night before commencement is that the Varsity Club honors all the senior athletes at the Senior Letter Winners Dinner. Now, obviously we can't be there in person together for dinner where we've had over 1,000 people each year the last 4 years in the Bright Landry Hockey Center. We are doing a virtual Senior Letter Winners Dinner and we invite all of you to join us next Wednesday night at 8:00. You can go look at sld2020.com where you can just check the Varsity Club website out. We've got a special show prepared. We've got special guests coming on, but we're gonna honor the senior class because they had their spring taken away from them. And this is just one way for us to say thank you to them before they have a virtual commencement on Thursday, next Thursday. So we hope you can join us. Thank you, Gerry.
Thank you, I can stay on. I just put all of our seniors in my background. I can stay on. Guys have questions. I got my wife's on call, so I got nothing to do. So I will stay on if you want to ask me any questions, or you know, I'm not going to be offended if you sign off. I'll stay on to the last guy. So I'm. Is that okay, Bob?
Absolutely. So ask away, everyone. Coach is wound out.
Hey, Coach, Chris Project, I have a sophomore playing. Quick question. Hello to everybody, and thanks for doing this. Are you encouraging the boys to play this summer, like in tournaments or, you know, getting together and trying to find some games to play, you know, obviously not playing a lot in the spring. Anytime they can pick up a stick is great, obviously.
Yeah, no, I think that you know, I tell them all the time, like, you never stop. You're a Division I athlete now. That your head going in a pillow. You're a son. You're a sibling. You never stop being that guy when you're a part of our program. So it should be top of mind, your improvement, your skill development, your role on our team, your strength, your conditioning, your nutrition, your sleep. That never stops. So, you know, I don't think that there's a, you know, that they should have, it's not like a moment, but it's, yeah, at this time, it should be an important part of their day. You know, their role in their home, them doing their schoolwork, you know, while that was happening. And you're a Division I athlete on a team that's trying to, you know, find its identity. So, yeah, I think, you know, and if there are no tournaments, then the workout you're doing in the backyard or down the street, or, you know, the work when no one's around, that I'm not looking over your shoulder. I'm not going to have a contact tracer on the guys on our team to see if they're sweating or running or anything like that. I want them to do it because of their fidelity to their teammates and their belief in our program. So, you know, that's, yeah, the short answer is yes. And if you can't find a team, find a way, I guess would be the simple message. My wife is on here somewhere in case, and you know, some people thought she was not a real person. Tracy, there she is. Oh, she's not, and she must have had to go deliver a baby or something. So she was here listening. So I actually do have a wife. She has not been able to move to Boston yet, but she's a total rock star and at the hospital right now.